Earlier this month, I had the opportunity to visit Mexico City, which has a really remarkable Jewish community and a really fascinating and unusual past. I was invited by Limud, which is this wonderful organization that provides all kinds of learning opportunities in a whole series of venues. We visited the old downtown of the city and found some beautiful 18th century architecture there, really fascinating. But it felt a lot like the Lower East Side must have been at the beginning of the 20th century, with lots of bustle and activity. You know, it was really a fascinating place. It was just a few days past the Day of the Dead when we visited it, so there were some strange kind of like shrines still around, especially on the old Jewish street, Calle de Jesus Maria, the Jesus Mary Street, which was unusual for the central core of the old Jewish neighborhood. But in fact, there was a synagogue of Jesus Maria on this street, which is kind of ironic. But it's the textile region where there were all kinds of businesses tucked away in little tiny corner stores, many of which are still owned and operated by Jews. You can see mezuzahs in the doorposts of a lot of them.
And so, why does Casa Mary decide to keep a mezuzah?
You know, it's really still quite an active place for Jews to visit and to work.
And it has never stopped working because there are Jewish businesses in the area. So they live somewhere else, 1 hour from here, but when they come here, they work. At 2 o'clock they come, they eat a kosher meal, and they go back to work.
One of the downtown synagogues was renovated at the early part of the 21st century. And my favorite part of the renovation is that the upstairs women's gallery is, perfectly fine and functional on one side. But in order to balance it out, they put an identical structure on the other side of the room, but there's no access to it. So it's purely for show. The second synagogue, just a few doors down, had, of course, you have to have two synagogues on the same street, right? One that you daven in, one that you don't get caught dead in. But the second synagogue has a kind of like a sleeve-like in structure.
But they have this interior facade, this like patio, because every synagogue is also a social meeting place. And there are two buildings. The one that you saw, the office.
Yeah.
And upstairs there was a kosher restaurant for some time that all the businessmen or the immigrants used to come here. No, this is very Eastern European.
Yeah.
And it was a copy of a synagogue from the beginning.
I really thought these menorahs that flank the Aron Kodesh had a distinctly Mexican feel to them. And afterwards, we spent some time looking at the modern synagogues in Mexico City, which are really quite gorgeous.
I'm Jack, de Mexico, and also soy un ciudadano de Latvia. Que siga tu papá en YouTube. Muchos saludos. Bienvenida a México cuando gustes con tu esposo.
Well, this is the Shara Shamaim Synagogue from the Sephardic community of Mexico. It was built in the style and influence of the Sephardic communities and synagogues in Spain. It has a beautiful, you will see, I don't know, it's from North Africa and other places, which is with oil, not with electricity.
Wow, beautiful.
It's natural oil. Do you see?
Yeah, I see. That's beautiful.
Did you not look?
Oh wow, look at that. Gorgeous.
It's very active. This is a very active community. We're recovering from the pandemic, but it's a very active community.
Oh, thank you.
These are remarkably large synagogue complexes with, you know, huge cavernous sanctuaries. I had the privilege of meeting with Chief Rabbi Abraham Tobal, who invited me to speak to several rabbinic colleagues of Mexico City, and that was a distinct pleasure. And then he led us personally on a tour of the Mount Sinai complex there, which really is so inspirational. There's so many spaces for learning. And I was especially amazed when he showed us what they have in the sanctuary in the Aron Kodesh, in the Holy Ark.
Wow, it is, they are very impressive.
These are Chagall windows, you know.
These are Chagall windows?
Yeah.
Wow.
12 from the Shvatim. And these two big Rabbanim. But look this.
Okay, I'm coming.
Maybe you never
saw. Oh my gosh.
So big.
This I've never seen. Wow.
I need to see how many stones you fed a lot.
Oh my gosh, this is.
Look. Come here,
they're beautiful.
Look how many. These are all in one. Look.
This is gorgeous.
Look, don't have place. Wow.
It was really interesting to see a Mexican flag where normally we'd see an American one. And these synagogues have like beautiful restaurants inside them that are really more like community centers, but they're gorgeous and they're all over the city. We rounded out our visit by going to the archives, which is housed in a beautiful facility right next to a renovated synagogue. And the director of the archives gave us a personal tour, which was really amazing, and they had actually curated a few objects for us to see.
The first book of the Central Committee of the Jewish Community, as I told you, remember the date that some of the last Jews that could go escape from Germany. You know the J, the big J,
yeah.
It wasn't really established by the Germans. This was an ask of this of Switzerland. Switzerland government trying incredible. Supposedly neutral Switzerland,
yeah.
Asked the Germans to.
The Ashkenazim are a minority in Mexico City, but I also had the opportunity to visit one of their amazing synagogues as well. And I was especially impressed with the stained glass window in one of the sanctuaries, which has the verse from Ezekiel 37:21. It really impressed me that despite the tremendous natural beauty of Mexico and the strength and vibrancy of this community, they still had that same yearning for Zion, that one day they would be taken out from their places of exile around the world and brought back to the land of Israel.